Hola, buenas noches. Bienvenidos a todos. Good evening. Welcome to all. My name is Abelardo de la Peña Jr. I'm the Director of Marketing and Communications with La Plaza de Cultura y Artes. Welcoming to today's En Casa con La Plaza. It's a beautiful Tuesday. We usually don't do these on Tuesday evenings, but this is a special one. Before we get started, let me just tell you a little bit about what's going on in La Plaza. First of all, I'd like to thank our sponsors, Aetna CVS Health, Union Pacific Foundation, and California Humanities and the National Endowment for Health, making this possible via the CARES Act of 2021. Okay, if you're joining us on Zoom, please, you could use the chat feature to let us know where you're viewing from. You could see us, you could just go do shout outs. Let us know that you're out there. Use the Q&A feature as well. If you have a question, we'll take your questions during the conversation, or maybe later on. If you're joining us on Facebook, same thing. Use the comment section there to let us know where you're viewing from, and also do shout outs, ask questions, and so on. All right. At La Plaza de Cultura, we've been open now since June full-time. The museum, wonderful exhibits. LA starts here, Calle Principal, the view from here, and our newest conflict, patriotism and conflict fighting for country y comunidad, a wonderful exhibit centered around the Chicano War term, which took place 51 years ago. I advise you all to come by as soon as you can to see it, but it'll be around for a little while, until June of 2022. My gosh, we're almost there. Also, we have our programming in place. You can come by, and this weekend on Sunday, we have El Encuentro de Jaraneros, an incredible almost full day from 12 noon to 9 p.m. With Jarana, Musica Jarana from Veracruz. We have some incredible groups, musical groups, and danzantes will be there ending with a fantastic fandango. Right, so let me set this up for you. Every year, the students of Albert Celis, a social studies teacher of Thomas Starr King Middle School located in East Hollywood, create incredible, heartwarming, and powerful films and art projects about Dia de los Muertos. We all know we celebrated Dia de los Muertos just a little bit over a week ago, and it was a full, all of LA, Southern California joined in the commemoration of our antepasados, our ancestors. But these students, throughout this time of year, they give their heart and they create these incredible and powerful films that are rarely seen in public or made by youth. So we're gonna be bringing up the teacher, the mentor, the person who puts it all together. Please join us, Alberto Celis.
Thank you so much, Alberto Celis here. Buenas noches, hello everyone. It is an honor to be with all of you this evening. I want to thank La Plaza de Cultura and Artes, Jimena Martin, and also En Casa con La Plaza. Thank you, Abelardo, for this amazing opportunity to showcase my students' film and projects virtually En Casa con La Plaza. Gracias.
Oh, no, it's our pleasure. You shared with us what these students did, what they have done for several years now, is my understanding. Tell us how it all began.
How it all began. Well, it's something that I've been doing for numerous years working with LAUSD. But at Thomas Starr King, I started 10 years ago, and this year was the 10th year anniversary of remembering our heroes and loved ones. And just, a new school, a new opportunity to bring cultura, to bring history, to do projects that students do with amor, with love, and yet, they become historians. They interview their parents. Their parents, their loved ones, relatives, about people that they really cared about, social issues, and they share them in class. It's beautiful, and yet by hearing these stories, I would tell myself, I cannot be the only one to be witnessing this. I need to share this with other classes, other students. So I would have assemblies for the whole school. So that's been, I'm proud of that, at Thomas Starr King, that I have done assemblies for 2,000 students and communities. So it's a big fiesta. It's a big celebration.
All right. Well, just to backtrack a little bit, obviously, in order for you to teach, you know, for the students to be able to produce these incredible videos and memories, they have to learn it from somebody, and that being you. Tell us a little bit about your background in this.
A little bit about what? I'm sorry, I wasn't able to hear you.
Your background in video or production. What background do you have in order to be able to impart this knowledge to your students to put together these incredible videos?
Well, I'm a social studies U.S. history teacher at Thomas Starr King, but I've been with LAUSD for numerous years, and I've learned through trial and error, try different types of projects, and I feel that I want to give students a voice, and having them tell their voice, tell their stories, and let them know that their voice matters. This project and other projects, whether it's this or others, it's crucial to let them tell their story. And I can, and yet when they know that their story is going to be heard by their peers, they put a lot more effort. And then they start to believe, like, oh, my story matters. Okay, what I do matters. So they try to do their best, and you're going to soon see what they have done. They've done with love, and sure. And there's no,
but also with skill, with technical skill in filming, in videotaping, interviewing, and then editing and producing this project. And how do they learn these skills?
Well, they learn it, it takes time. It takes time for them to learn. Some of them have the skills, and yet I tell them they have options. So some of them have skills, and some of them, have numerous skills where they could do arts. So I tell them, incorporate arts. And this is done digitally through different apps. This one here is done, with oil pastels. And so they have choices. And that is something that I've learned, that I need to tell them, I need to give them options. I need to give them options and choices, because, and when I do that, this beautiful work comes together. And yet at first I'm like, what am I thinking? But yet when they have choices and options, the work that they put together is just incredible.
All right. Well, we have a message here that the mariachi gala is on. So through this technology, we're going to use some other technology right now. And if you could tell, just let us know what's going to happen now, Alberto.
So what's going to happen, I just want to share my altar.
Yeah, tell us a little bit about that.
Where I have my grandparents, where I have my father, where I have Naela, Marciano that just recently passed away earlier, a couple weeks ago, and other loved ones and family members. It's important to remember
course it is. And that's what that's
their experience. So
this is the time that it's a tradition within a lot of families of Mexican American Latino descent to of course bring back their loved ones through these offerings, through the altares, through the ofrendas. So now tell us what's going on now.
Well, I just want to introduce, just say a few words. Welcome to Remembering Our Loved Ones and Heroes, Dia de los Muertos, Day of the Dead, Virtual Art and Film Festival within Casa con la Plaza. Prepare yourself for an incredible celebration of life as we honor, remember, and celebrate our loved ones and heroes. Students did art projects, made films, wrote biographies on a loved one, hero, or social issue that mattered to them, and became historians in the process. They interviewed family members, heard and shared stories on how their loved one lived and passed away, obstacles and challenges they faced, as well as their American dream and the many lessons that we can learn from them. Dia de los Muertos is an opportunity to honor, remember someone you love, and to also look at your own history, roots, and culture, to know where your ancestors and you come from, and to learn and appreciate them. We have a lot prepared for you this evening. Be a great virtual audience and enjoy the festival. It was done with amor. Students' loved ones will not be forgotten. They are loved, cherished, live on, and remembered. Let me get the films ready to go. Thank you for your patience. I'm gonna share my screen. And here we go. Enjoy.
This is my aunt, Zoria Garciela Lemos. My family called her Tia Chela. She was born in 1942 and lived until 2014 when she died of diabetes at the age of 72. She was a sweet and caring person. She was almost like a mother to me and my siblings. Ever since I found out she passed away when I was 6, there's been a huge empty gap in my life that aches every time I think about her.
A pesar de que de sus problemas, ella siempre trataba de estar optimista. Ella se veía muy feliz con toda la familia. Le gustaban las reuniones de familia.
¿Qué obstáculos enfrentó?
Bueno, mi hermana enfrentó varios obstáculos, como siempre en la vida. Pero el mayor obstáculo que presentó fue el venirse de Los Ángeles, de El Salvador para Estados Unidos. El segundo fue cuando ya estaba aquí, porque cuando uno no puede el idioma de aquí, se le hace más difícil todo.
¿Qué lecciones podemos aprender de ella?
Sí, lo que podemos aprender de lo que, como ella era, es pues su amabilidad, su amor que tenía por los demás. Y pues era una persona muy activa y alegre.
¿Desearías que ella todavía estaría viva?
Sí. Porque nunca pensé que ella se fuera a ir tan pronto. Nos hace falta mucho.
Sí, desearía que todavía estuviera viva. La verdad es que dejó un gran vacío en la familia.
¿Cuál es su memoria más reconfortante con ella?
Lo más reconfortante era cuando estábamos toda la familia reunidos. Ella se sentía muy contenta, todos estábamos muy contentos. Uno opinaba de una cosa, otros opinábamos de otra, y eso era lo que ella quería.
¿Quién era Tía Chela?
All right, round of applause for Haley. If students are, I would greatly appreciate if you write in the chats what you think about the students' films, because they're watching and they wanna know what you think. So if you don't mind, share your thoughts in the chat, what it makes you think about, what you liked, anything would be greatly appreciated. Students want to know, thank you.
My papa Salvador and my mama Lidia were some of the most kindest and most loving people I ever have known. They are or were my grandpa's parents. They were huge on family, so for the smallest occasion, for the maybe a comunión or a boda or a quinceañera, we would always throw huge parties and have an amazing time because we are family and they inspire what I want. They both love my dancing very, very much. So, on my great-grandma's birthday, I danced for her. What I didn't know was that it would be the last time I ever got the chance to.
Feliz cumpleaños, te quiero. Here's my mom. Estoy hablando. Okay. Feliz cumpleaños, te queremos mucho y te extrañamos aquí en Los Ángeles.
I love my great-grandparents very much, and I will forever miss them. But a couple of things that they left with me were, when you love someone, you love them with everything you have, whether they're your family, your friends, or a significant other, because you want to make sure that they know you love them, because you never know what'll happen. And another being, never be ungrateful for what you have, because what you have, others may want. One of the things that was extremely difficult for them to overcome was COVID. Because of their old age and because of the medical difficulties they already had, when COVID hit, and unfortunately they couldn't protect themselves, it hit them hard. My grandpa was going blind and my grandma, you know, she wasn't breathing so well. My family and I think that because they loved each other so much, my great-grandma actually passed away a month after my great-grandfather died, not knowing that he had passed away, because their connection was so deep. She knew she couldn't live without him, and I know that wherever they are, they're happy together. And really, that's the only thing I can ask for.
Round of applause for Sophia.
My dad was an incredible and inspiring person. Even though his life started out pretty rocky, he overcame many obstacles like being adopted and never really knowing his biological parents. My dad's biological mom gave my dad to her best friend, who was a loving and caring mother. Baseball. He started playing when he was 5 or 6 years old. When he grew up, he wanted to be a professional baseball player. My dad had a great sense of humor. He was always making someone laugh, and he was the funniest person that you knew. He also loved playing video games like Nintendo. He would play nonstop until it burned out and he needed a new one. He would also play with my cousin Olivia, but would cheat because he knew all the codes on Super Mario. When he was in his mid-20s, he came across a difficult challenge. He was in a gang and he went to prison. Many years later, he finally overcame the challenge by heading to the Dream Center for recovery.
In 2006, my dad met my mom at Angelus Temple, which is the church connected to the Dream Center. Then in 2007, my dad graduated from the discipleship program. Then in 2008, I was born. When I was a year old, my dad started to work at the wine guard. When I was in first grade, he started working at PCA as a mechanic because my aunt found him that better job. A few years into the job, my dad decided to go to college to be a licensed mechanic. He worked so hard to pass his exams, and it was difficult for him to still have his job and study as well. He eventually graduated at ATC as a certified mechanic, and he applied to get a job at LAX. He found out that he got the job a few weeks later.
He loved his job at LAX, and he was very talented at it. He would always send me pictures of him working or of the airplanes that would pass by. On November 7, 2019, this is when everything changed. My dad had a heart attack and died. I will forever love my dad, and I miss him so much. We can learn many things from him, like him being a gang member to having a good job and going to college while fighting his battles too.
Okay, guys, round of applause for those two videos. And now you are in for a very special surprise. I apologize. I apologize because there's a special treat for you, but you can't see them. I cannot click and share my screen, but you're going to be able to see them. You know, we're improvising here. You're going to be able to see them with my phone. Are you able to see them now or no? Are you able to?
Yes, we are. Yes.
Yes, you are.
Just hold it a little bit lower and closer to the camera.
Okay. So I just lost my, okay. There we go. Okay. So right.
Great.
There.
Perfect.
Right there. And there's the mariachi, but I there's a few words that I would like to say about this very special mariachi. Is the mariachi ready? Okay. I want to say a few words. I'm very happy to introduce. Can you see it? I'm very happy to introduce the next performance, Mariachi Gala de Los Angeles. has been a Southern California favorite. They are a family mariachi. Mr. Rojas inherited this art form from his father, who has been performing most of his life. His sister was the first to inherit his father's passion for mariachi music, then him. And now it's being passed down to his niece. The Rojas family has much love for mariachi music, culture, and each other. Put your hands together, everyone, for El Mariachi Gala de Los Angeles. You're on, Mariachi Gala de Los Angeles. Can you make the screen larger, Abelardo? Can you full screen it? All right. Thank you so much. Mariachi Gala de Los Angeles. Thank you. So sorry for the technical issues that are beyond our control. I'm going to now go back to the performance and films. This is Ballet Folklorico de Los Angeles and my student, eighth grade student from ESM, Sofia Alvarado. I'm going to share my screen. I'm sorry. So round of applause for Ballet Folklorico de Los Angeles, Sofia Alvarado, eighth grade student from ESM STEAM. Hope you enjoyed that. And now we're gonna see more student videos.
John Lennon was an English singer, songwriter, musician, and peace activist. He was born October 9, 1940, and later on achieved worldwide fame as the founder, co-songwriter, co-lead vocalist, and rhythm guitarist of the Beatles. John Lennon had many passions. One of those was the 60s peace movement. The first song I ever listened to by him was Imagine. It is one of my favorite songs because I remember singing this with my mom. This song was written to represent the injustice and inequality in the world. He wanted people to imagine a world with no need for greed or hunger. A world where there is peace and acceptance of everyone, no matter your gender, sexuality, or background. Now here are two videos of John Lennon. These videos have shaped
and changed the opinion of many. I think everyone should be given the opportunity to see this because it states many important things that can help us today.
I think our society is run by insane people for insane objects, objectives. You know, and I think that's what I sussed when I was 16 and 12, way down the line. But I expressed it differently all through my life. It's the same thing I'm expressing all the time. But now I can put it into that sentence that I think we're being run by maniacs for maniacal ends, you know. If anybody can put on paper what our government and the American government, etc., and the Russian, Chinese, what they are actually trying to do, you know, and how, what they think they're doing, I'd be very pleased to know what they think they're doing. I think they're all insane. You know, but I'm liable to be put away as insane for expressing that. You know, that's what's insane about it.
Every country's had a violent revolution for one reason or the other. Not one of them has the freedom we're all talking about. So we're saying give peace a chance, you know, like nobody's ever done it before. And it's not a matter of, we're not thinking in terms of 10 years, we're thinking in terms of peace forever, you know. And that everybody's talking about now, I want peace now. We can get peace now if we want it now. And the left wing talk about giving the power to the people. You know, anybody knows that the people have the power. All we have to do is awaken the power in the people. The people are unaware. It's like they're not educated to realize that they have power. They put the politicians in power. They vote for the local mayor. The people do it. But the system is so geared that everybody believes that just the father will fix everything. The father being the government. Government will fix everything. It is all government's fault. You know, shake a fist at the government. Well, we are the government. The people are the government, and the people have the power, but we must try and make them aware of this.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, I have a question for the audience, all of you out there. Do you have power? Do we have power? Can we create positive change? I hope so. I want you in the chat to indicate what power you have as an individual, as us united together. And what would you like to change? Please share in the chat while we see more incredible films. This next film is by Rocco, and it's an awesome film by...
Roberto Clemente was born August 18th, 1934, in Barrio San Anton, Carolina, Puerto Rico. He was the youngest of seven siblings in his household. During the year of 1954, when Roberto was only 20 years old, he was signed to the minor leagues by the Brooklyn Dodgers. He was then drafted by the Pittsburgh Pirates and soon played in the major leagues, playing in the outfield for them for 17 years, starting during 1955. Roberto Clemente was an amazing hitter and fielder. He had an amazing arm. This boosted him to receiving many awards, such as being on the All-Star team 15 times, getting 12 Gold Glove Awards, winning 4 National League batting titles. He was the National League Most Valuable Player in 1966 and the World Series Most Valuable Player in 1971. He boosted an amazing overall batting average of .317, 240 home runs, and 1,305 RBIs. He also was one of the very few MLB baseball players of all time to get 3,000 hits or more. Roberto Clemente was also a great father and husband. He had 3 children. His wife, Vera Clemente, and his children were Roberto Clemente Jr., Luis Roberto Clemente, Roberto Enrique Clemente.
Thank you.
Roberto, besides from being an amazing ball player, was also known for his humane efforts. He was a large humanitarian. He helped everybody in need, from people in America to Central America. He also created free baseball clinics for kids that grew up poor, like himself, in Puerto Rico. He was in pursuit of helping others and making sure everyone was okay. Then one year, 1972 to be precise, an earthquake struck Nicaragua. Roberto saw this happen and began to raise money to help his friends and the people who lived there. He was the honorary chairman of the relief committee to raise $150,000 to help these people. The relief committee was also able to gather 26 tons of relief supplies. When his plane left to deliver all these supplies to Nicaragua, the plane
Roberto was dead.
Suffered a failure of the number 2 engine.
Roberto
that night,
was a
trailblazer plane, along
for baseball
with the supplies,
since he was black
the
and Hispanic.
And he was the first Hispanic baseball player to be put in the Hall of Fame. He is inspirational to me because he makes me want to help the community and those in need using your voice if you're a professional athlete, which I hope to become. He has inspired many Hispanic baseball players to help their community and has changed baseball forever for the better. Roberto Clemente, father, son, husband, trailblazer, inspirationalist, Hall of Fame ball player. We will always remember you, Roberto. Rest in peace.
All right, round of applause, everyone, for Rocco. Let's round of applause for Rocco in the chat. Please indicate what you thought about his film on Roberto Clemente. I know you're here, Rocco. Thank you for joining us tonight. Great film, everyone. Rocco is here in the audience. Tell him what you thought about his film. Now we're going to see a film done by Milo. Milo Hazard on Kobe. But I have a question for you. Are there any Laker fans out there? Are there any Kobe fans out there? Who misses Kobe? In the chat, indicate how you feel about not having Kobe. Share what you think about this film once you finish and thoughts about Kobe. Here we go, without further ado, dedicated to Kobe.
Welcome to the Kobe Show.
Remember me, though I have to say goodbye. Remember me, don't let it make you cry. For even if I'm far away, I hold you in my heart. I sing a secret song to you each night we are apart. Remember me, though I have to travel far. Remember me, each time you hear a sad guitar. Know that I'm with you the only way that I can be. Until you're in my arms again. Remember me.
Kobe Bryant was an extraordinary basketball player. He was drafted into the NBA at the young age of 18 years old and was one of the youngest basketball players to ever play in the NBA. He was selected with the 13th pick in the 1996 NBA draft to the Charlotte Hornets, and he was later traded to the Los Angeles Lakers, where he would go on and have a wonderful 20-year career. He would go on and win 5 NBA championships, 2 Finals MVPs, a Most Valuable Player Award, an 18-time NBA All-Star, a 4-time All-Star Game MVP, and 11-time All-NBA first-team player. Kobe Bryant was also a father of Natalia, Gianna, Bianca, and Carpi Bryant, and he also was the husband of Vanessa Bryant. Kobe will never be forgotten and will always be remembered as a legend. Rest in peace, Mamba, and we miss you to this day.
You know I'm back, like I never left.
I never left.
Another sprint, another step. Another day, another breath.
Another breath.
Been chasing dreams, but I never slept.
I
on life is a piece of mind. Seeking a find, I can sleep when I die. Want a piece of the pie, got the keys to the ride. And I'm straight, I'm on my way. I'm on my way, get out my way. I'm running late, what can I say? I heard you die twice, once when they bury you in the grave, and the second time is the last time that somebody mentions your name. So when I leave here on this earth, did I take more than I gave? Did I look out for other people, or did I do it all for fame? Legend is Exodus, searching for euphoria, trudging through the mud to find the present, no ignoring us. Got 20,000 deep up in the street like we some warriors. My mama told me never bow your head. Whoa.
I feel good.
Round of applause for Milo, everyone. Hope you enjoyed that piece. Tell Milo what you thought. Share your thoughts, please, with Milo. And next, we have a very special treat. You know, I mentioned earlier that I've been doing this at Thomas R. King Middle School for over 10 years. And drill team has always been part of the journey. You are about to see the 2021 Laser King drill team. They have shown how luchando one can accomplish anything. Drill team is reminding us que sí se puede through their artistry. They didn't make excuses. They found solutions through learning from each other, growing together, and shining always. Here's a luchador piece dedicated to all the people who have lost a loved one during these difficult times. Always remember, que la lucha nunca se acaba. The struggle never ends. Enjoy.
La lucha libre en Denver, miércoles 12 de diciembre, National Western Stadium Arena, La Parquita USA.
Everyone, round of applause. Round of applause.
Thank you.
see this. I'll always look out for you. Yeah, that's what I'll do.
Okay, I'm going to stop and share my screen. Just give me a moment, please. Here we go.
Hi, my name is Karen, and this is my mom. Her name was Placida, but everyone used to call her Christina. Back in 2014, she was diagnosed with breast cancer. She fought a huge fight and won. She beat cancer. We were all so happy. She was one of the happiest people I've ever met. But unfortunately, she passed away on July 27, 2019 due to esophageal cancer. She lived a great life. She never gave up. She lived a great life by always looking at the bright side of things.
¿Cómo vivió mi cuñada en su vida?
Mi hermana vivió su vida muy alegre, la disfrutó al máximo, siempre sonriendo y dando a las personas con muy buen corazón, y la verdad su vida la vivió al máximo.
One of the biggest obstacles my mom had to face was cancer.
Lo primero, para llegar a este país fue el inglés. Era aprender inglés para poder salir adelante.
My mom's dream was to succeed in every aspect of life.
Su sueño americano fue ayudar a su familia, darle lo mejor, darle un techo a su familia, y cosa que lo logró.
One lesson I learned from my mom was to never give up and always be strong.
Las lecciones que podemos aprender de ellos es que tenemos que llevarnos bien como familia, a luchar por lo que nosotros queremos, porque no sabemos cuánto tiempo estamos en esta vida.
My favorite thing about my mom was that every time I was in a bad situation, she would always pick me back up. I remember her saying, "Sé fuerte como tu mamá," which means to be strong like your mother.
Le gustaba bailar mucho y es la primera que salía a bailar. Eso me gusta mucho de ella.
Yo la extraño bastante. Uno veces pienso de ella cuando, like, en momentos muy raros. De las memorias que son felices, que cuando la miraba en las fiestas y estaba tan feliz, o en cualquier lugar que esté mi tía, que sepa que la amo. Gracias.
Bueno, yo extraño a mi tía Cris, la extraño bastante. Ella nos dijo, o nos dio buen consejos de siempre seguir adelante. Mi tía Cris fue una tía maravillosa y la extraño bastante.
The thing about your mom, it was because she was a great tía for me.
She takes care of us. She was nice to us. She plays with us. She does a lot of things for us. And that's what I like from my mom.
¿Qué es lo que te gusta más de tía Cris?
¿Me sabes de comer?
Ser, su sonrisa, el carisma que ella tenía, muy alegre, sonriendo todo el tiempo, y que era una muy buena persona.
Mom, my favorite thing about mom was that she was always happy even though she was mad or sad, and she was always there for me.
Hasta que en mis brazos tú estés.
All right, round of applause for Karen's film. Round of applause, everyone, for Karen's film. That was so beautiful. Powerful, heartfelt. I hope you all loved it. Karen is here. Please share your comments to with Karen. Tell her what you thought. I'm gonna share my screen. This one is another great piece. It's more of an art piece explanation, and it deals with Maya.
The life of my great grandma Eva. For this project, I made a drawing and I wrote down some facts and history that I'll be reading out as you look at the drawing and my process for that. So, Eva was born on July 17th, 1922, in Lodz, Poland. In 1940, the Nazis, who had taken over Poland, turned the Jewish section of the city of Lodz into a ghetto, building a fence around it and preventing essential supplies such as food and coal from being delivered. As a result, many people in this section died of starvation and illness, including many members of Eva's immediate family. In 1941, the Nazis made the decision to empty the Lodz ghetto and send all the Jews to the concentration camps in Poland as a part of the final solution, which had to do with how to exterminate the Jewish people as efficiently as possible, because starvation and illness was a slow process. Eva arrived in Auschwitz by train with 17 other teenage girls. All entered the camp. Some arrivals, if ill, were not allowed inside and killed on the train platform. All arrivals were tattooed with an identifying number. Eva was given the number 39793 with a triangle below the numerals. With a great deal of resourcefulness, Eva survived 4 years in Auschwitz and was freed by Russian soldiers who approached from the east. She recovered for a year in a hospital in Poland and then decided, with many other Jews, to go to Israel. Though she met her future husband in Israel, her ultimate desire was to relocate to the USA and start a life there. Perhaps the part of the reason was due to the myth that in America, money grew on trees and the streets were paved with gold. She settled in Brooklyn, New York, and was a mother to 2 sons. Later in life, she visited local public schools as part of a program to educate students about the Holocaust. She spoke to them in their classrooms. She participated in the USC Show Up Foundation project, spearheaded by Steven Spielberg, of recording the stories of Holocaust survivors for the future. She passed away in 2013, and people who know her will remember her positive outlook on life and her sense of humor. For this project, I was reluctant to start, and I felt like there was a lot of pressure on me because of the heavy subject that I was dealing with. But my family thought it was an important story to share, and I'm glad that I did. I can't begin to portray the obstacles that Eva faced, so I decided to take a less obvious approach. I wanted to make something that would represent family and passing stories from one generation to another. In doing this project, I was able to learn about this incredible story, mostly thanks to my ho-ho and my mom, and it makes me proud to know I'm connected to such strong and brave people. People like great-grandma Eva, or like my wonderful living relatives.
The U.S. has seen a startling rise in hate crimes against Asian Americans.
Since Asian Americans only getting worse,
hate crimes against the Asian community have surged.
Disturbing surge of racist attacks against Asian Americans.
Every time my family or friends go for their walk, I'm panicking inside, just thinking all the things that could be happening to them, of people viewing them as women and being easy to target.
What we are seeing is just the tip of the iceberg of what is actually happening in the communities.
Thinking, am I going to be part of that statistic soon?
The president is promoting this kind of language. He refers to and has referred to the virus as the China virus, as the Kung flu.
Science, medicine will eradicate the China virus once and for all.
It comes from China. That's why.
Kung flu? Yeah. Kung flu.
And I know that we're running short on time, so I'm sorry. I'm skipping a few pieces because of time. But guys, I know that you're everyone's at home. Let's celebrate. And I would like to, you know, I can't see you guys at home, but hopefully this next piece will make you want to dance. So dance at home to this great song. Next piece is by Catherine Tenorio.
Selena Quintanilla Perez was an American-Mexican singer, songwriter, artist, businesswoman, fashion designer, and much more. Born on April 16, 1971 in Lake Jackson, Texas, music was always a big part of her life. Her father taught her and her siblings to sing in Spanish as they grew up only speaking English. Born into a musical family, her dad was in a Tejano band, which she joined when she was just 8. She became the lead singer in her family band at 10. Then soon when she was 11, she left school to pursue singing because she would take the crowd by storm with her natural and beautiful voice. The obstacle she faced was being a woman and living in poverty, which she got out of when she started performing. Not only that, but racism against her as well that is portrayed in Selena the movie.
You like this? This is nice. It's
pretty. I like the color.
Excuse me, miss. Can we try this on?
Well, I don't think you'd be interested in that one.
Why?
Well, because that dress is $800.
You know what? Could you just take it off the mannequin? We'd like to try it on.
As the years went on, she wrote and published many songs and a few albums, but her first hit didn't come until 1992 when she released her album, Entre a mi Mundo, in which her hit song, Como la Flor, at the time reached number 6 on Billboard's Hot Latin Songs, then in 2013 reached the number 1 spot. In 1994, she released another album called Amor Prohibido, which had more of her hit songs such as Si Una Vez, No Me Acuerdo Más, and one of my personal favorites, Bitty Bitty Bum Bum. She attended the 36th Grammy Awards as she was nominated for Best Mexican American Album as she won and became the first woman in history to do so. In 1995, she performed her last performance in Houston's Astrodome, and then a month later, as her dad, Abraham Quintanilla, confronted Selena's business partner, Yolanda Saldivar, about taking money from Selena. He wanted to put a stop to it, but then Selena got killed in the hands of Yolanda Saldivar, as she says,
was an accident.
Personally, Yolanda's side of the story is unbelievable as there is so much more to it that she never mentioned or talked about. Even though I wasn't alive when Selena was, my mom and family has always embraced her music when I was little. My mom would specifically always play Bitty Bitty Bom Bom, and it's one of my favorite songs as the beat is very catchy. I remember my mom showing me clips of Selena performing on stage and dancing, which really inspired me to dance like she did. Even if you're Hispanic or not, Selena is a big inspiration for all and someone who everyone can learn from. As she says,
and I feel that, you know, if you have a dream, don't let anybody take it away. And you always believe that the impossible is always possible.
Okay. Thank you, Rampa, for all the filmmakers, the students, the performers. Appreciate all of you. What you think, Abelardo?
That was fantastic. If we could stop the share of the screen, Mr. Celis, please.
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay.
Oh, no problem. No, I'm just in awe of the incredible projects that were executed by your students. Very touching, very heartfelt, as we see in the comments here on Zoom and also on Facebook. Raul Rodriguez from Claremont says these were beautiful. Guadalupe Diaz Isa joined us. That John Lennon piece was a bit surprising, but very heartfelt, and it. I love the way that it focused on his activism more so than his music. And Guadalupe Diaz Isa says she was a big fan of the Beatles. Christina Magallanes Jones stated here on Facebook that these are very moving remembrances. And she's from La Crescenta. And Guadalupe and then Veronica Viramontes, she gives a lot of applause. No, this was fantastic, Mr. Celis, and I just want to commend you for having such incredible, way that you reach out to your students to help them to create these.
Gracias.
So just to thank everybody that joined us, Victor Villa, Haley de la Paz Lucero, who are your students here, Rocco Lagano, his was a nice, I believe he did the Roberto yes. Clemente piece.
Yes, he did.
Karen Aguilar, a former student, I believe, she's loves Selena. Linda Guthrie, I believe she's your partner in teaching.
Yes, thank you, Linda. Good to thank you for joining us, always being there Appreciate it, Linda.
No, and you know, talking, of course, some of these were very personal, talking about fathers, talking about mothers, talking about tías. But then also they touched on bigger social political, like the one that talked about Asian, unfortunate racist actions against Asian Americans over the past year and a half of the pandemic. So I really applaud you and your students, and I know that our audience really enjoyed these. And if you joined us and you'd like to see this again, we have recorded this. We'll be posting it on our YouTube page. So Mr. Alberto, any final thoughts on this presentation, please?
I just want to say gracias to Plaza de Cultura, you for opening your doors to us, to my students, and giving them a voice, a place where they can share their films with others and have not just my classroom, not just Thomas Starr King Middle School, but the whole community. And I think that is important to do. So muchísimas gracias. Greatly appreciate it.
No, it was definitely our pleasure. And I thank you for reaching out to us and to my colleagues, Jimena Martin, who's our Director of Programming and Cultural and Culinary Arts, and also Gina Alicia Ramos, who's our Director of Education here at La Plaza de Cultura y Artes. Of course, we're a museum and a cultural center, but also we're a place of education. So I invite teachers out there, including you, Mr. Celis. We have a virtual field trips. If you go to our website, to our education tab, students and teachers and students can now learn about art, history, culinary arts, gardening arts through these virtual field trips that we just started off a couple of weeks ago. So again, thank you so much, Catherine Tenorio. This was an amazing experience, and a round of applause to everyone who participated. I agree with you, Catherine. This was definitely amazing. And I'm just blown away by it all. And I know you put a lot of effort into it, as your class did. You did three assemblies last week. You had a very busy Tuesday, Dia de los Muertos. And looking forward to what you produce in 2022.
Yeah, thank you so much. There were eight assemblies. Yes, one for every period, and yet tonight you were able to view part of the show of A, but there were numerous parts. There was a total of 60, 70 films. And it was just so difficult to like, okay, they're all amazing and worthy and powerful. But at least some were shown, and hopefully in the future, the others or more films will be able to be shown and presented. But thank you for the wonderful opportunity. It's important for students to know, to see their work, and know that others care.
All right, well, Victor Villa is asking, please post all of them on your YouTube. But we do have a YouTube at La Plaza LA, and we recorded this particular En Casa con La Plaza session, so we will be posting them. And do you, Mr. Celis, do you post them on a YouTube site yourself, or where can people see these films plus others?
It's through Schoology, but I will give you the link, and those that are interested will just, all they have to do is click on the link and they'll have access to that. So okay. I'll send that over to you later.
Well, thank you so much. All right, great. Well, to all of you that joined us tonight in Casa con la Plaza, this was a special treat indeed. It embodied the spirit of Dia de los Muertos, of course, and it continues. Of course, we shouldn't remember the departed, our ancestors, our heroes that have passed on just one or two days of the year. We should honor them and remember them and celebrate their lives throughout the year. And this gives us an opportunity to do that. Just to let you know what's going on in upcoming En Casa con la Plaza, tomorrow we have a replay of a session that we did back last summer, Voices of Latino Vietnam Veterans. As you know, this Thursday is Veterans Day. And so we had Tomas Summer Sandoval, Tom Sandoval, and Manuel Sandoval, two are Vietnam vets, Latino Vietnam vets, and one is a professor at Pomona College who is conducting oral histories of Latino Vietnam vets. So it's an incredible, interesting discussion with them that'll take place tomorrow at 7 o'clock here on En Casa con la Plaza. And then also, then finally on Friday, November the 12th at 7 p.m., we have Dan Guerrero. He's on with us every other week, and he'll have as his guest Richard L. Saldivar, the founder and executive director of the WAL Las Memorias Project. It's a wide-ranging community and health and wellness organization dedicated to Latinx and LGBTQ communities. So all of our previous En Casa con la Plaza sessions can be seen on our Facebook page at La Plaza LA and on our website, lapca.org, and on our YouTube page as well at La Plaza LA. Thank you to our sponsors, Aetna CVS, to the Union Pacific Foundation, and also the California Humanities and the National Endowment for the Humanities, and to our staff at En Casa con la Plaza, making all this possible. So once more, muchas gracias, Señor Alberto Celis.
Gracias, Abelardo. Thank you, everyone, for joining, making time, your busy schedule this evening. Thank you so much. Good night, everyone.
All right. Buenas noches a todos. Bye-bye. Mariachi Gala de Los Angeles. From Mariachi Gala de Los Angeles, thank you all very much for letting us perform a little piece of Amor Eterno. And we thank you so much for that. Tell us, where can we hear Mariachi Gala de Los Angeles, Alberto?
Yes, definitely. They have Instagram. So you just Mariachi Gala de Los Angeles. You should be able to find them. They are a local favorite here in Southern California. I hope you were able to hear the family tradition of cultura, of amor. And I apologize for the technical difficulties. Mike, I'm so sorry, but shout outs to you, Mariachi Gala de Los Angeles. Look them up and, call them because they'll do weddings. They'll do events at La Plaza de Cultura and Artes as well. I know you guys are constantly having major events, great events there, but they're right here in the community.
Great. Well, we posted their Instagram page there on Zoom and the chat, and also on our Facebook page. And we definitely will. I'll be sharing this information with Jimena Martin, our director of programming. Well, thank you. And then here you go. You can also find them on YouTube, Facebook, and Instagram. Here's their phone number. All of you out there can write that down before it goes away. I'm also posting it on our.
Yes, Mike, post the information, Mike, right now in the chat.
No, he did. He has it there.
Great, awesome.
All right.
Awesome.
Okay, buenas noches a todos. See you all soon on En Casa con la Plaza. Bye-bye.
Buenas noches. Thank you so much. Thank you, everyone. Take care.